Have you started yet?
Not yet.
Okay, everyone. Y'all will sing with the, I think she's ready. We're gonna do a song called Leaning on the Everlasting Arms.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms.
Watches online from other places. We're thankful to be able to make our worship service available to folks that way. We have a couple of announcements this morning. Sandra gave me an announcement sheet and I put it somewhere. Here it is. Bible study continues on Tuesday night. This week we'll be doing part two of Corinthians. They were such a mess it took two books to try to get them figured out. Our pastoral search committee requests that everyone participate in a spiritual type exercise, which was handed out before church last week and today. If you choose to participate, please select the answers that best describe what you personally prefer as a part of your spiritual experience. If you choose to participate, you'll receive a packet with info on your personal spiritual type, as well as type of the church as a whole based on the responses received. If you're already thinking about the next pastor and you want to participate in this so that the church has some of what you're looking for and what your strengths are to help with that. On Saturday, next Saturday, 5:28, and the following Saturday, 6:24, there will be a training session for setting up for Sunday service. The training will start at 1 p.m. Both sessions will be the same, so you only need to attend once, the 28th or the 4th. See Sandra if you have any questions. You say, well, what do we have to set up? The altar, the stands, everything you'll be given directions on how to do. We used to do this, remember? Remember people used to plan ahead and be willing to do this and such? So be here the 28th or the 4th at 1 o'clock. Any other announcements? Come up so I can see you're younger than I am.
It's all right. This is just a small gift of our gratitude and appreciation and wishing you a wonderful and happy birthday.
Oh, thank you.
Happy birthday.
Several happy birthdays sung to me on the phone. One's from my aunt. And what's funny is she just makes up all kinds of words for the next parts, you know. And I'm listening going. Thank you all very much. I hit the big 71 this yesterday, and you know, I know there's some here older than me, and there's some younger than I, and everybody keeps telling me it's just a number.
That's right.
Keep telling yourself that. Our next song will be Hallelujah, Your Love Makes Me Sing.
Hallelujah.
a mountain far beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me when I am surrounded. Your love carries me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Your love is surprising. I can feel it rising. All the joy that's growing deep inside of me. Every time I see you, all your goodness shines through. I can feel this God soul rising up in me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Your love is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me when I am surrounded. Your love carries me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes
Sunday when I was there at Charlotte for their final worship service. It was amazing. Some of it was fun and funny, and some of it was very sad. If you have any interest in seeing that, let me know by sending me a message, and because I saved it in my messenger. When they closed the church, they had to close down everything. Their Facebook page, their website, their mailbox, all of that. So I managed to snag that before it disappeared. But I appreciate that for travel prayers. And so many of the people there know and love you all and send their greetings. Before too long, Felicia and Kim are going to come and sing. If you've ever watched their worship services, you know who they are. And later in June, there's a woman who used to be in the Winston-Salem Church, and she's going to come and sign for us one Sunday.
Oh,
that's exciting, yes. So on our prayer and praise list, Edward has prayers. He's in the VA hospital. And he thinks he'll probably be there till Wednesday. Sue asked for two friends who are looking for housing, a place to live, and for a friend that had to put their fur child cat down.
Oh.
Yeah. We need to keep Jan in prayer. Jan, who's part of Valley View, she has two wonderful dogs. One of them's named Tara, T-A-R-A, not E-R-R-O-R. And she's had the dogs for a long, long time, and Tara is having a really bad time.
Aww.
And so if you'd keep Tara and Jan in your prayers. Pat had praises for her grandson, Jackson, who had his 11th birthday, and celebrated a birthday party yesterday at a stable. That would be kind of interesting. And prayers for the right person to buy her house. If you're friends with Pat, look at the house on her Facebook page. It's a nice house. And you might know somebody that's maybe interested in it, or yourself. And she also asked for unspoken. Continuing prayers for our friend Sharon, who's waiting on some test results to come back. Another prayer for a mom I know that's awaiting a breast biopsy to be done and come back. Some concerns there. And also for our neighbor Betty, who's had a horrible swelling in her knee. She thought it was arthritis till she realized it was the one that had an artificial joint. And so it's been really hard. She's going to keep it up. And she goes back to an orthopedist tomorrow. Other prayer requests or praises that you did not get sent in to me, Mo?
Yes, Kathy's sister is going to have a surgery. It's cancer, and so in prayers for her. What day is it?
The 26th.
The 26th.
Yeah. Okay. Another hand I saw. Paula?
I've been diagnosed with skin cancer on my leg.
Oh.
They burnt it off, and she says, if it doesn't dissipate on its own, give her a call. Well, it hasn't. So okay. I'm going to have to get it looked at more deeper.
Keep that in prayer. Did I see your hand, Laura?
Yeah, for my family, prayer request for my Aunt Sabrina in Texas. She has been out of work now for several months and is now at the point where she's having to move in with my other aunt because she hasn't been able to find work. So just prayers for that situation. She's in her 60s, so it's a big, you know, should be looking towards retirement and is now having to look for a new job and new living situation. And praises that my youngest sister is potentially going to be having a new career option, which we're very excited about. She's been kind of floating back and forth, so that's a big thing. And then on behalf of Sammy Deal, he has visited with us back when we were over on Jameson, prayers for his parents and then one of his friends who recently had a mental health crisis.
Okay. So, aunt looking for work, sister got a good lead on a job, and Sammy's parents and friend. Hallelujah. Yes, Kathy?
Praises for some answered prayers. I had posted on Facebook about somebody who had a whopping budget of $30 for groceries, and two people have answered to help, and she now has plenty of groceries. And also for my friend Elizabeth, which I've said she's lonely and needed some things. Well, we have found somebody that's going in, and she's doing some laundry for her, which is good because she had no way to do it. And we do her grocery shopping, but she's doing some cleaning of the house, and so the village is coming together to help people out. So some answered prayers.
Yes, Mitch.
Yes, I have a praise report.
Please.
And we'll have to go back with Spanky. Spanky is a miracle. She liked to die. And because of the prayers of y'all and other people, I have to give the Lord the honor, praise, and glory because she's still here and she's perfect.
Amen.
I want to thank the Lord and give him praise and support and thank y'all for all y'all's prayers. I had to go through surgery. I'm fantastic. All
you know, we got one. Hang on just a minute. Whenever MCC Charlotte had a booth at the Pride, I always had a space to serve some of the community if they wanted, but also it was available so they wanted prayer. And that was a really wonderful time, special time with people I didn't even know. Well, when I was down at Pride a couple of weeks ago to do the opening prayer, I knew Midge was going to be having her surgery, so we just stepped aside in the middle of Pride and had a prayer there. So don't ever think you can't pray in unusual places.
And I thank you.
Absolutely. Sandra.
Praises for trips turning 14 tomorrow.
Oh, boy.
Wow.
Wow.
Jesus.
Hallelujah. And prayers for Kelly and Sandra in that process.
Yes.
Teenagers are fun.
We were just talking about that before church. One person that was with us at 110 Kirk was probably a sophomore in high school, and he just turned 30. And I'm just like, and Joe Cobb's daughter, who we knew since she was a little bitty kid, just turned 30. Somebody's getting old around here, folks. Any other prayer requests or praises? Patty.
This is a praise. The twins that we were praying for who were born so teensy tiny are almost out of NICU. Everything's unhooked except for the oxygen. And yesterday she got to take them out and dress them, and they are adorable.
Aww.
They were little.
Tiny little things. Now they're almost finished with NICU and got to put clothes on them. Yay. Anyone else? Any unspoken requests? Anything on your heart? Just would like somebody, look around right this minute. Some of you have seen a ring, some have seen a watch, a sleeve, a hand. Whenever that comes to your mind this week, that's God saying it's your turn now. It's your turn now to pray for them. Let's pray. Loving God, we thank you indeed for this place we have to worship. We thank you for the kindness of Valley Community and how they've opened their facility and their hearts to us. We asked that you be with Jan, and she has to make some decisions about Tara. Make her know that she is surrounded by a group of people praying. We thank you, loving God, for answers to prayer, and the fact that we can bring those back and say it, and even walk in the door, being healed in 100%. We thank you for that, loving God. We thank you for all the ways you open us to be able to worship you and to pray for each other and to be present. I ask that you continue to keep us humble, to realize what a gift you have given us in each other and in your Son, Jesus, and be willing to always give thanks and be willing always to share that. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Good afternoon, good afternoon. I was thinking about the call this morning and how I ought to approach it. I'm not very good at getting up here and talking to you, although I know most of you well. And those out there in TV land as well, or not TV land, showing my age. But anyhow, out on the web and we are given so very much. When we talk about giving for forwarding the kingdom of God, we have to look at how Christ provides for us. What if you took your cup and he turned the faucet off halfway? He doesn't do that. What if he turned it off just before it got to the full mark? He doesn't do that. He gives us gifts every day that runs over that cup, down our hands, and into whatever lies below. We are starting a new chapter with the church. We sold the building, and now it's time to be thinking about a new building. We're having the pastoral search happening. And all of that, it takes funds to do things and to plan. I ask that you will give today as you are able, and in the community this week, as you are able. Any way that you can forward the kingdom of God, that's what we ought to be most interested in. If you're out there in TV land, if you could hit the, is it a like button? Uh-huh. And you can donate through the
website.
Thank you so much. God bless you all.
Come and set us free.
us healing with warm embrace. Show your power, make your presence known. Holy Spirit, come fill this place. Breath of God, we need a touch from you. Shine down on us with the light of truth. Stir our hearts, set our spirits free. Holy Spirit, come fill this place. Holy Spirit, come fill this place. Our hearts are hungry for that perfect peace. Our souls are thirsty for the joy you bring. So send your glory, make your praise complete. Send down the rain, touch us once again. Holy Spirit, come and fill this place. Bring us healing with your warm embrace. Show your power, make your presence known. Holy Spirit, come fill this place. Breath of God, we need a touch from you. Shine down on us with the light of truth. Stir our hearts, set our spirits free. Holy Spirit, come fill this place. Holy Spirit, come fill this place. Holy Spirit, come fill this place. Fill this place. Holy Spirit.
Loving God, we do ask for your Holy Spirit to fill this place. We ask, loving God, that you fill not just this place, but our hearts, our spirits, so that we'll listen for that quiet, still voice, or sometimes that loud voice, that leads us to be followers of you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Scripture today comes from Psalm 67. I read you one version a while ago. This is slightly different. Before I read that, I have to tell you about a worship service at General Conference one time. Reverend Jerry Ann Harvey was having a healing service. It was very quiet, very spirit-filled, you know, all that stuff. And lo and behold, all of a sudden, the signer, we didn't know them, but from his phone, we hear, "Hello? Hello? Are you there?" And it was like, oh my gosh. And we realized it was his partner calling and he left his phone on. So when the door knocked as we were praying for the Holy Spirit to come, I had to get tickled. We're always open to anybody and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Psalm 67. God marks us with grace and blessing. Smile. The whole country will see how you work. All the godless nations will see how you save. Let people thank and enjoy you, God. Let all people thank and enjoy you. Let all far-flung people become happy and shout their happiness because you judge them fair and square. You tend the far-flung people. God, let people thank you and enjoy you. Let all people thank you and enjoy you. Earth display your exuberance. You mark us with blessings, O God, our God. You mark us with blessings, O God. Earth's four corners honor him. Okay, Marie's going to do some road jumping here. You know, do you ever think about when that door is closed and it opens? Do you ever think about who might be walking in? Somebody was talking to me about that the other day. And they said, you know, you just never know who's going to come in. You just never know. And in some churches, that's been more of a concern than others. And I always had somebody I could look at and kind of go like that, and they would check somebody out. It was something very unusual. But what would happen to make you turn and look when somebody comes in? Now, because of how we're seated, no offense, no problem to you, but because of the way we're seated, we see everybody that comes in. I don't know about you, but if that door opens after everybody's come in, I can't just go, oh, well, I have to see who it is. I remember in the early years when we were over there on Jamison, and Jerry Falwell was at his peak, raising Cain about everything, I often would say to the congregation, what would you do if Jerry Falwell walked in the door? Oh, yeah, people still groan. Huh? If he walked in the door now, I'd be real scared because he'd be dead. But I tried to make people see that even if it were Jerry Falwell, that we would give them a bulletin, we'd make sure they knew where the hymn book was, and proceed on. One time in Charlotte, we had protesters out on the street, and our church sat back a ways, and six people dressed in Sunday best came walking up to the door, and they were with that group, and they said, we just want to worship with you. And everybody said, okay. And they went to strategic places, you know, in the congregation, but they were welcomed. People treated them, no matter what their reason for being there. What would you think if they opened that door and somebody walked in full military garb? Whether that's as a officer or someone with the backpack and the camo, it'd make us look, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, it would me, especially if they were armed. What if someone came in who was dressed way up? You know, in MCC, we do not worry about being dressed up. I have seldom been in MCC where I thought, boy, that person was overdressed. Too often, that's not the case. But what would you think? What would you think if somebody came in dirty? What would you think? He's fine, he's fine. What would you think if someone came in a black suit and a tie? I told you about my little church in Ventura. This guy kept coming in. We met at an old-time California ranch house, and there was a long room, and there was a light right by this one door. And he came in for several weeks with his big old black Bible and black suit and black tie. I thought, he's trying to get us on something. He's trying to get us on something. And I finally, one Sunday, managed to catch him before he left. And he said, I can't hear this at my church. He said, and I can't preach this at my church. But I know this is a place where we can hear all about God's all-encompassing God.
Amen.
See how I was way off on that? I guess also, you know, it's natural to wonder when somebody comes into our space. And part of it's because MCCs have often been not the safest place to be. But you know, after this past week in Buffalo and in some other places, is there a safe place to be? Only in your spirit and in your readiness to meet God. I'm not going to let that keep me in. I'm not going to let that make me scared to be out. It's going to make me alert. It's going to make me alert. This first verse, which says, marks us with grace and blessing, it says, smile. In most of your Bibles, that would be the word selah, S-E-L-A-H, which can either mean pause, think about this. Think about how God blesses us. Think about it. Or it can mean a musical pause. They didn't know. Either way, it's sometimes good just to take a deep breath and listen. The whole world will see how you work. You know, at one time, there's lots of conflict going on. And I had a marker on my desk that said, bless the whole world, no exceptions. That's what this psalm is talking about. Bless the whole world, no exceptions. Some of us would want to put some exceptions in there, wouldn't we? I mean, be honest. There are times when you think, God surely can't love that person. Even though in your spirit you know God does. And this psalmist really stepped out of his upbringing. How many times have you heard people say, well, that's how I was raised? My comment always is, you're a fur piece from being raised. You know? That's how I was raised. But this psalmist, who was a Jewish man, really stepped out of his comfort zone. Because the Jews thought they were truly the apple of God's eye and the only apple of God's eye. And the rest of us were heathen. The rest of us didn't have a chance unless we converted. And this psalmist has a broader view. Some of you have come to have a broader view. Isn't that great? Some of us are kind of stuck still in some of the other corners. But he says the whole country will see how you work. Well, how are these people going to see how God works? Unless God suddenly, you know, pulls a tree up or suddenly creates a building. How are people going to see how God works and the power and the glory and the love of God? The only way they can see it is in us. The only way they can see is how we deal with people, how we treat people. You say, well, you mean here in church? Oh, no, we're on good behavior here for the most part. For the most part. But how do we treat that person ahead of us in the grocery line? Here's one of my pet peeves. Who's bought a boatload of groceries. The cashier says that'll be $112.19. And they subtly, especially ladies, go in their purse and slowly bring out a checkbook. Or even slowly bring out a card. And slowly, you know, didn't you know when you got in that line you were going to have to pay? You know, but how are people going to see that love and mercy of God unless we show that love and mercy? Jesus has already been here, and all that Jesus has left to show people, that is us, is that us. And he even says the godless nations will see how you save. I think about this times when, and it's hard to understand our country giving millions and billions of dollars elsewhere. But for some people, that may mean the difference between life and death. Between life and death. Let all people thank and enjoy you. Not all of us are going to thank the same way. Not all of us enjoy God the same way. Some of us enjoy God out in nature. Some of us enjoy God listening to music. Some of us enjoy God being with God's people. But whatever that is, we need to learn to enjoy God. And even refers in the psalm to the far-flung people of the earth. Do you realize that in this time, people pretty much were born and died in the same town? How many of you were born in Roanoke? I was. I can raise my hand. How many of you have ever lived somewhere else other than Roanoke? See, we get around. Some of us get around a lot. But the psalmist here was able to see God's vision. That didn't sound good. The psalmist was ever just able to see God's vision for people he couldn't even imagine. That's one thing I'll say about my Southern Baptist background. They were big on missions. And, you know, we had a missionary in Paraguay that we worshiped, and we supported. And she'd come in and tell us all kinds of stories, things about eating monkey and all. Anyhow, she'd tell us all kinds of these stories. And you learn to realize that God was in other places than Cambria, Virginia, thank goodness. It says that God judges them fair and square. We don't always do that judging fair and square. We want everybody to measure up to our measurements. We want people to talk about God the way we talk about God. We kind of want people to worship like we worship. In the old Cambria Bank building in Christiansburg, there's now a Seventh-day Adventist church. When that first opened, some of the people were all upset because Seventh-day Adventists worship on Saturday. Well, how can they be Christian if they worship on Saturday? And my dear mother, bless her heart, said, I've been to one of those services. I'm not there, but I've been to other churches. And they're just like we are. We get so tied up into everything has to be just like we do it. Just like we do it. Let all people thank and enjoy you. Let all people thank and enjoy you. How do we enjoy God? You know, some of us are still afraid of God. Some of us still have that Ziggy cartoon in our mind where there's a big thumb coming down out of the sky and there's little Ziggy and he's getting ready to get squished. We worry that God's out to get us. I don't think I could enjoy. If one of these dogs that we have in here, bless their hearts, if they were snarling and aggressive, I would not want to be around them. I would not be around them. We have a friend who has a Chihuahua that's not from heaven. And I don't want to go near that dog. I don't want to go near that dog. But I enjoy Ivy. I enjoy Ruby. Yeah, because I can relate to them. How do we enjoy God? When was the last time you had a really good meal? Me, last night at Ichabod's, okay? When was the last time you had a really good meal? And you enjoyed it. Well, you didn't just enjoy it for the 10 or 15, 20, 30 minutes you ate. You enjoyed it when you thought about it later. You enjoyed it when you could maybe hear tell somebody about it. We enjoy God in so many different ways. And then last it says, you mark us with blessings. You mark us with blessings, oh God. I was reading this and I think about how people get so caught up and worried about the mark of the beast. You know, Tim LaHaye stuff. That's not what this is talking about. This is talking about God being so real to us and our realizing so much how good God is that it leaves a mark. Not like a little mark on our cheek, but a mark in our spirit. Have you ever been around somebody that you just know they love God? But you've never talked to them about religion. You've never talked to them about where you go to church. You just sense it. That's that mark that they're talking about here. I talk about Barbara Haynes. I probably mention her too often. I get blessed sitting beside her in church. She didn't have to, she wasn't even preaching. I was blessed that way. And then it says, earth's four corners are under him. Do you remember the last verse of the book of Matthew? I know somebody here is because we had to learn it in GAs. Go ye therefore and teach all nations. The psalmist was already realizing that all the world would one day hear of the glorious love of God. All the world. Four corners to that psalmist may have been that hill, that hill, and that hill. But he had a much broader vision. He was excited about his God. He was proud of his God. He wanted other people to know, love, and adore his God. And my question is, do you want your God? Do you want your God? Would you be willing to explain your talk about your God and hope somebody else would like that? Would other people want your God? You know, I've been in some churches where I did not want their God. I didn't want what they were saying and talking about. But sisters and brothers, we have the opportunity to share and know and live a God that other people want. And the psalmist here says, as we bear that mark, as we share that joy, people everywhere will not only know it, but want it. Do you want your God? Think about it. Amen. Amen. You came up early today. I was reminded last Sunday again of all the different ways that this meal can be consecrated. I was reminded how differently the pastor there did it than I sometimes do. But the elements were symbolic of the body of Christ, and the juice was symbolic of the blood of Jesus, and all the other is just fixings, if you will. Some people say if you don't say it right, are we going to be in trouble? Once somebody shared communion and they lifted the bread and they blessed it and they did this. And somebody came to me after church and said, are we in trouble? That's not how you're supposed to bless it. And I had to say, just relax. The blessing's in the heart, not in what the hands necessarily do. But that night, Jesus met with his disciples. He knew the future. He knew what was happening and they still were pretty much in denial. But at any rate, he still had to minister to them in this part of their meal. And he took bread from the table. He lifted it to heaven. He gave thanks for it. He blessed it and he broke it. And he said, this is my body broken for you then and today. Take and eat of it, each of you. He took a cup from the table and he lifted it to heaven and he gave thanks for it and he blessed it. And he turned to them and said, this is my blood, a sign of a new covenant, a sign of forgiveness for all people, for you. Take and drink of it that night and today. And whenever we eat this bread and drink from this cup, we're reminded of what's called the mystery of our faith, not mystery as in can we solve it, but something that's almost unable to be fathomed. We share together that Christ has died, Christ is risen.
And Christ is coming again. Hallelujah.
One of the joys of my years in Metropolitan Community Church is to always be able to say we practice an open communion. All of you know that, but it's important to say it sometimes. No one is excluded from this table. No Pope is going to tell us whom we can serve and whom we can't. Everyone is welcome to this table. I say welcome because you're not required either. When you come forward, you'll be given a wafer dipped in grape juice, or if you prefer, you can pick up one of the individual servings to take back to your seat. Either way, I'll be honored to share a brief blessing with you. Loving God, bless these elements in whatever form they take today. May they be a reminder of us forever, of your loving, your giving, your caring spirit. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.